morning, my first words must be, of course, to thank the organizers, and most especially my compatriot, Santiago Bourdieu, for this kind invitation. That gives the European Parliament an opportunity to participate in this interesting gathering. I've been in politics now for 24 years, and normally I am surrounded by politicians. So it is always a pleasant change to share some time with people that really know what they are talking about. What I intend to do, very modestly, this morning, is to present you a broad picture of the mindset in which my colleagues and myself in the Industry and Energy Committee, in the Environment Committee, in the Internal Market Committee, or the Economic and Monetary Affairs Committees, the mindset in which we live when deciding on energy questions. We, of course, interact with lobbyists, with experts, with the Commission, with member states in a very long and sometimes cumbersome process. And at the end of this, we must try to improve the legislative proposals that come from the Commission, table amendments and try to make legislation better. So I thought it would be interesting for you to have this general overview of this mindset in which we take these decisions and we do our work. Henry Kissinger once said, "Statesmen will be judged by history according to their ability to assume changes." He was expressing the same idea that Darwin applied to his theory of evolution. And if there is one field which has showed its ability to evolve over the last few decades, it is indeed energy. Since the coal and oil industrial revolutions at the end of the 18th and 19th centuries, the energy scenario continued without dramatic change until the end of the 20th century. I will focus today on these recent changes which help constitute the situation today. The first change is the increase in energy demand due to the economic growth experienced by countries of considerable population, like China and India. According to the International Energy Agency, the world's total energy consumption increased from 4,670 million tons oil equivalent in 1971 to 8,550 million tons oil equivalent in 2009. That means it almost doubled in less than 40 years. Now we are in an economic downturn, and that momentarily stopped this trend of growth. But global primary energy demand grew by a remarkable 5% in 2010. The International Energy Agency's forecast is that this demand will increase by one-third between 2010 and 2035, with 90% of this growth coming from non-OECD economies. This increase in energy demand is not difficult to understand if we consider that the world's population is set to increase from its current 7 billion to more than 9 billion by 2050. A second important change is the pessimistic prediction about the medium-term longevity of oil, gas and coal, which are currently the world's main energy resources. This is a discussion which is not over, as certain factors could prolong the life of oil and gas. The five Arctic coastal states are seeking, with the help of the United Nations, to resolve the delimitation of the Arctic region, which is, as you know, an important area for oil and gas. As well as this possibility, the use of new technologies to exploit unconventional oil and gas could delay the end of their use as energy resources. Indeed, according to the International Energy Agency, oil and gas production will increase in the years to come. They predict that global oil production will reach 96 million cubic meters a day in 2013, due in part to rising output of natural gas liquids and unconventional oil. However, oil share in global primary energy use is expected to drop from 33% today to 27% in 2035. Unconventional natural gas, on the other hand, may have a promising future if environmental concerns are successfully addressed. Resources are estimated to be as large as those of conventional gas. Again, according to the agency, over a third of the increase in global gas production from 2008 to 2035 will come from unconventional sources. Their share of production rising from 12% in 2008 to about 20% in 2035. Furthermore, natural gas is the only fossil fuel which is expected to increase its share in the global mix over the period from now until 2035. However, fossil fuels have an expiry date, and their use contributes to the third important global factor I will refer to immediately, which is, of course, climate change. Climate change is a big issue at the moment, and also in the European Parliament, as you can guess. Despite some skepticism, nowadays it is broadly accepted that CO2 emissions must be reduced in order to limit global warming, the objective being to prevent the increase in average global temperature from rising to 2 centigrade above pre-industrial levels. This renewed green consciousness has put fossil fuels in the spotlight because of their polluting effects. These three important factors have had tangible impacts on the global energy mix and in energy policies. I would like now to look at three of these impacts. The most obvious is the development of renewable energy, whose supply has significantly increased in absolute terms. Some renewable energy sources, such as wind, solar, and biomass, are undergoing a real boom, the result being that today renewable energy represents 12% of the world's primary energy supply. Another consequence has been higher competition for energy supply, up to the point where some producing countries have used energy as an aggressive instrument of pressure in foreign policy. Security of energy supply has therefore become a goal of every energy policy. And a third fact is that the concern for both security of supply and reducing emissions helps to explain why, before the Fukushima accident occurred, there seemed to be a nuclear renaissance, with many countries pledging their commitment to lifetime extension programs of existing nuclear plants and even to the construction of new ones. Nuclear energy currently produces slightly less than 40% of the world's electricity supplies and little less of 6% of the total primary energy use globally. The Fukushima accident was a real turning point, as some countries such as Germany, Belgium, Switzerland, Italy have since reversed their nuclear plans, and even Japan has established an end date for the lifespan of their nuclear fleet. The International Energy Agency, supporting the International Atomic Energy Agency prediction, has forecast a slower global increase in nuclear power output in comparison to what it was anticipated in 2010. But it has also pointed out that countries such as China, India, Russia, Korea have not changed their policies and are continuing to expand their nuclear power. The International Energy Agency even warns that restrictive policies on nuclear energy could have far-reaching consequences, such as boosting demand for fossil fuels, putting pressure on energy prices, and making it harder to combat climate change. The United States' recent decision to authorize the construction of two nuclear power reactors in Georgia confirms that nuclear fission is still a viable option for ensuring energy supply without worsening climate change. Now that we have seen an overall picture of the new energy scenario, it is time to look at the European Union response to these challenges. Energy has been at the core of the European project. Among the three founding treaties of the European communities, two were related to energy resources, coal and nuclear power. Coming back to the present, the last treaty to reform European primary law, the so-called Lisbon Treaty, has given energy a solid legal foundation with a self-standing article. This is a formal recognition of the importance given to develop a common energy policy, which according to the new Article 194 of the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, should aim to first, ensure the functioning of the energy market, second, ensure security of supply in the Union, third, promote energy efficiency, energy saving, and the development of new and renewable forms of energy, and fourth, promote the interconnection of energy networks. In practice, the European Union has designed a wide strategy to achieve energy which is competitive, sustainable, and secure, and which allows the Union to ensure the uninterrupted availability of energy products and services on the market at a price which is affordable for all consumers and companies, while contributing to the Union's social and climate goals. To this purpose, the European Council established in 2007 three ambitious targets for 2020, which would have been branded as utopian only 10 or 15 years ago. Two of them are binding targets: to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 20% and to increase the share of renewable energy in the total mix to 20%. The third target is only indicative, is to reach a 20% improvement in energy efficiency. The European Union is also fully involved in a series of initiatives which aim to shape a sound and coherent European energy policy with three main priorities. The first of these is to advance towards a fully integrated true single energy market. The European Union has approved several legislative packages in order to liberalize the European gas and electricity market. The last of these, the third internal energy market legislative package, was adopted recently in 2009. It encourages the separation of production, transport and distribution activities, what is also known as unbundling. This means that energy companies cannot generate power and own the grid at the same time. The aim is to prevent network operators from discriminating against new users of the network in favor of incumbent players. The legislative package also reinforces national regulators' independence and creates the Agency for the Cooperation of Energy Regulators. Another crucial way of achieving fully integrated market is the improvement of energy interconnections, putting special emphasis on those which link Central Europe with peripheral regions, but not forgetting about the infrastructures which link our continent to third supplier countries. Since the introduction of the trans-European networks by the Treaty of Maastricht, the European Union has established the Trans-European Energy Networks guidelines, laying down the rules for their proper development. Currently, the European Union is in the middle of the legislative procedure to approve a regulation which will set out new guidelines in this field. This new regulation will give priority to 12 trans-European energy corridors and areas whose development will enhance our energy market integration. A market which is subject to open competition and connected both internally and to our external suppliers is crucial for improving our energy system efficiency and therefore our competitiveness, as well as for developing the external dimension of such a market. This goal has not yet been fully achieved. As the European Union Strategy for Competitive, Sustainable and Secure Energy itself recognizes, the European Union energy market is still largely fragmented into national markets, with numerous barriers preventing open and fair competition. Most energy markets remain national in scope and are highly concentrated and often monopolized by incumbent companies. In addition, regulated energy prices further reduce competition in many member states. In my opinion, this is one of the most important challenges the Union energy policy faces. We must strive to achieve the full implementation of the adopted legislation by member states and continue to promote the construction of the necessary infrastructures. A second priority is to achieve sustainable energy. According to the Union plans, sustainability will require decarbonizing electricity supply and reducing oil dependence in the transport sector, which represents around 33% of the Union's final energy consumption and 30% of the CO2 emissions. This dependence could be reduced by introducing fuels like biomass, hydrogen or electricity. All of the aforementioned measures are set out in the roadmap for moving to a competitive low-carbon economy by 2050, which is being discussed at the moment in the Parliament. It aims to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 90% in 2050 compared to 1990, an objective established by the European Council in February 2011. We can highlight the following steps on the road to sustainable energy. The promotion of renewable energy sources must represent 20% of our energy mix in 2020, as I said, with a specific target of at least 10% renewable energy in the transport sector. To facilitate this goal, a directive was approved in 2009, obliging member states to establish national action plans which set targets for 2020 for the share of energy from renewable sources consumed in transport as well as in the production of electricity and heating. In 2005, the European Union was the first major economy to set up an emission trading system. This ETS works on the cap and trade principle. This means there is a cap or limit on the total amount of greenhouse gases that can be emitted. Within this cap, companies receive emission allowances which they can sell to or buy from another as needed. At the end of each year, each company must surrender enough allowances to cover all its emissions. Otherwise, heavy fines are imposed. The number of allowances is reduced over time so that total emissions fall. Currently, there is a great debate with regards to this system, as critics point out that because of the economic crisis, there has been an over-allocation of allowances. Therefore, there is an opinion in favor of amending the system in order to withhold a significant number of them. The regulation of carbon capture and geological storage, CCS, was the object of a directive approved in 2009 to establish a legal framework for the environmentally safe geological storage of CO2. Concern for the environmental impact of energy consumption is also seen in the Union's position on nuclear energy, which provides now around a third of the electricity and 15% of the total energy consumed in the Union without contributing to climate change. Despite ideological prejudices, the European Union has not declared itself against an energy resource that is the core of one of the three treaties on which the European communities were founded. It prefers to give freedom to member states to decide on their energy mix and focus on improving security of installation and managing nuclear waste. The European Commission recognizes the advantage of nuclear. If I quote from the website of the Commission, we can read, "The sector represents a source of energy with low carbon levels and relatively stable cost, which makes it attractive from the point of view of security of supply and fighting climate change." This is the official position of the Commission. In addition, after Fukushima, the Union has agreed on voluntary stress tests for all of its 143 reactors. Results of these tests will be known this year. A third priority for the Union energy policy is improving energy efficiency. This is considered to be the most cost-effective way to avoid an increase in emissions. Furthermore, it enhances the competitiveness of European industry by reducing costs. Last but not least, the technological advances European energy companies may achieve in this field will put them at an advantage compared to non-European ones. The Union has been especially active in this field. We must make reference to the two energy efficiency plans, 2006-2011, and to the numerous EU laws adopted on issues like energy performance of buildings, energy end use efficiency and energy services, eco-design of energy-using products, labeling of energy-related products, cogeneration, and others. Furthermore, a directive on energy efficiency is currently being discussed in the Parliament. This directive contains a large number of different measures which can be implemented to improve energy efficiency: renovation of public buildings, public purchase of energy-efficient products and services, a national energy efficiency obligation scheme for utilities, energy audits in large companies, smart meters, accurate billing, and promotion of cogeneration and demand-side programs. And a last priority of our policy is security of supply. As the strategy for competitive, sustainable and secure energy states, energy is the lifeblood of our society. The well-being of our people, industry and economy depends on secure and affordable energy. That's why the Union is concerned about Europe's degree of energy dependence, which stands at around 50% and is expected to increase. This dependence makes Europe vulnerable to political use of energy by our suppliers, as shown by the gas supply crisis with Russia in 2009. To deal with this situation, the Union has imposed an obligation on member states to maintain minimum stocks of crude oil and or petroleum products, and has established measures to safeguard security of gas supply, such as requiring reverse flows to be established in all cross-border interconnection between member states where this possibility makes sense and is cost-effective. Also, the Union is studying the economic and environmental cost of exploiting unconventional gas, as there are reserves in Europe, especially in France and Poland. Both the Environmental Committee and my own committee, the Industry and Energy Committee, are discussing own initiative reports on this subject. And the Union is also trying to develop a foreign energy policy. There is a growing need to create European energy diplomacy in order to give Europe a single voice to defend its interests abroad, with a special focus on secure supply of energy. With the negotiating power brought by its status as representing the world's biggest energy importer, Europe can reinforce its relations with supplier and transit countries. Some countries and regions are a priority for this European Union energy diplomacy in order to diversify routes and sources of supply. Northern Africa has great potential for solar and wind, and Caucasus and Central Asia are essential areas for the diversification of gas supply. To this end, the EU supports the construction of infrastructure such as the Southern Corridor, which will directly link the Union gas market to the largest deposit of gas in the world. In addition, there are efforts to improve the internal coordination of Member States' foreign policies. The European Parliament is about to approve an information exchange mechanism with regard to intergovernmental agreements between Member States and third countries in the field of energy, which will prevent Member States from signing agreements which have an impact on the internal market for energy or on security of supply. A single European voice will be useful not only to ensure energy supply, but also to tackle worldwide challenges such as climate change, environmental and safety concerns, greater energy efficiency, new technologies, and high and volatile energy prices. All these measures should make the Union advance towards a future energy mix in which renewable energy, gas and nuclear power will gradually replace oil and coal, making a reduction of greenhouse gas emissions possible. As we have seen, there is a European Union strategy for energy efficiency at the current pace. However, this goal won't be achieved. In my opinion, there are three types of challenges we are facing. One is economic, the lack of funds in member states to implement all the measures recommended by the Union. The second challenges are technological. For example, we need to tackle the problems provoked by intermittent character of some renewable energy sources, as wind and solar, and also the lack of technologies that are sufficiently developed to decarbonize the transport sector, as electric and hydrogen vehicles are still not able to fully meet the demand of this market. And the third challenges are structural, such as the need to achieve a fully integrated energy market by means of liberalizing legislation and improve energy networks. And I will conclude. That's the part you were waiting for. I will conclude. At the beginning, I remember Kissinger's reference to the need for statesmen to be able to assume changes. The world is changing in very different ways, and we have seen some of these occur in the energy field. Growing global demand and the resulting competition for energy resources, combined with an increasingly critical view of fossil fuels because of their limited lifetime and their pollutant effects, point out towards new solutions. Without prejudice to the achievements already made in the energy field, if the European Union leaders want to go down in history as statesmen, or statewomen, of course, they must endeavour to realise the European Union's ambitious energy objectives, proving that we are able to respond successfully to the challenges presented by this new energy scenario. There is much at stake, and time is running against us. We know what we Europeans must do. So let us do it, and let us do it together.